Welcome back, everyone, to Los Angeles, where we're about to go into game number three between the Mad Banners and the Tricky Turtles. Jester, are you ready for game number three?
Oh, man. Game number three is like the delicacy for commentary, for esports. It is the best thing that can happen between two teams because they are neck and neck, and now it's all on the line. You got to pull out all the stops.
Yeah, you got to win here if you want to move on to the Epic Gate. Remember, loser goes home. So let's go ahead and check out the battleground. It will be the Garden of Terror chosen here by the Tricky Turtles.
All right, so Garden of Terror, we've seen it once already, but just as a reminder for you guys, three lanes. It's not the biggest of maps, but they definitely have those three that you still need to split up for. Day and night cycles. When the night overtakes the Garden of Terror, we will have those plants run amok. You still have six mercenary camps, however, as big objectives. If you can't get those seeds, try to get those mercenaries. But if you can, definitely go for those seeds. You see Zagara picking them all up, and the big guy there as well, 60 to his name. You collect enough, and you're going to get yourself a Garden Terror. This is where a player has to actually climb into it and control it. It's a little different than some of the other objectives because you have the power. Where do you want to go with it? What do you want to do with it? Offense, defense, split, or fight? You have a lot of options.
Yeah, really, the options that you cover in this battleground are what we're going to be focusing on for the teams. How do they use their terror? How do they defend against the terror? Remember, potentially in this battleground, both teams can have a terror at the same time if
Absolutely.
They collect enough seeds. They have to get 100 to unlock a terror and obtain those abilities. And remember, with one player jumping into that vehicle, they could potentially lose out on some kind of crazy team fight ability that they could use. So it is important which hero you actually put into that vehicle.
Keep saying it's a game of decisions, man.
Yep.
Who goes in there? Who do you lose out for some of these fights? And my bet is it's not going to be the Vala here. Sadaharu, first pick for the Mad Banners. That is a very mainstay assassin. She has been in almost every single match. She was the highest pick rate in the Heroes of the Dorm coming into the Super 16. It's a very solid pick.
I think for the Mad Banners, it's even more important to take Vala just because we saw how strong Tricky Turtles can be in it in game number one. Taking away that key hero might be a foundation issue that the Tricky Turtles might have to deal with. Just not having that hero might be something that they are not comfortable with. They will, however, pick
wow.
up the Lost Vikings, which they had in game number one.
That's an early pick.
That is an early pick, especially with Jaina here as well. But why do you think it's not the greatest pick in early stages here?
Because it's not a very highly contested pick. Going back and forth, we've only seen a few teams actually employing the strengths of the Lost Vikings. So picking it this early, Tricky Turtles either have something up their sleeve, this is their map of choice for game number three, or they were afraid perhaps the Mad Banners are actually thinking about it themselves. Those are the only two reasons for that early pick. Traditionally, you actually see it closer towards the fourth or the fifth pick in a lot of these drafts, and we've actually maintained that all the way until now.
Man, the Tricky Turtles picking up a tricky hero indeed, as the Lost Vikings are a little bit of the harder heroes to play in this game, but we'll see what exactly they'll be doing with it. An interesting pick indeed. The Mad Banners will be falling up into their own picks as well, and looks like we'll be getting Dan on Illidan here.
That is, if this is not a support to follow it up, I am going to start worrying a little bit here for the Mad Banners. The Illidan is definitely a big playmaker, and Dan so far has actually, I believe, been on supports. Now he's taking an offensive role.
Wrath, well, yeah, he's been playing, or Wrath by himself has been playing Warriors as well.
Yeah, so they've swapped.
Both players being showing their versatility here, and I wonder if it will pay off. So Illidan here now for Dan, Wrath on Tassadar. Those two will be neck and neck together. They'll be helping out each other a lot because Dan will need to be aggressive. He's a very high mobile character right now. One, though, that if he is stunned in any way, shape, or form, or locked down, he can be focused down very, very quickly. So watch for Wrath and Dan to work together here.
Now on the flip side, the Tricky Turtles, they see that combo of the Illidan and the Uther. Immediately, they take Monkey Lamps on top of Rhaegar. He had some phenomenal heals in game number one on this iconic hero. And this is, again, a big deny, because if the Mad Banners had a double support dream of the Tassadar and the Rhaegar, that is going to be trouble for the Tricky Turtles indeed. So I like that pickup, but here is a panda we don't get to see much.
Wow, looks like we're going to be seeing Chen, and Chen is a very interesting hero, fun to watch in my opinion, as he has a fun mechanic that he can play around with, in which he actually drinks brew, and the brew will give him shields and allow him to be a little bit more tanky than normal. Here are his abilities. He has Flying Kick, Keg Smash, and Breath of Fire, and those don't do the most damage, but they allow you some decent utility. The Keg Smash puts down some slow. He's usually a hero that's very good at diving into a fight and then using the heroic ability Wandering Keg, which will actually knock players around. You might see Storm, Earth, and Fire here, but Wandering Keg is the one that we see more often, especially against an Illidan.
Yes. Yeah, because the Wandering Keg is what we call unstoppable. You can't stop it. That is why it is unstoppable. So once you start rolling, the only way to actually stop it is to, you know, destroy it. And that can be a tricky thing to do because, again, we got our Rhaegar. We might actually even have a second support. We still have that last slot because we have now damage, support, and the Warrior of Chen. It's really fun to see Chen. I'm actually really sad that we don't get to see him much here in North America. But wow, here is definitely a hero of old.
Very interesting picks overall for the blue team, as they're going to be falling up into Mr. Burgies with Arthas, and they do have Kikisho on Uther. So Uther, natural choice. He synergizes well with Illidan, so Dan and him, Kikisho and Wrath will be working together. But Mr. Burgies on that Arthas. Arthas is a hero that's a little bit on the tanky side, but he also has pretty solid slows around him. He can really lock down some players if he gets on top of them. The problem is he doesn't have much mobility, so a hero like Chen can dive in and knock Arthas back. What do you think about this pick?
Arthas has definitely fallen a little bit from the higher pick rates. We didn't really see a lot of him in the previous rounds, even up to the round of 64. But Arthas by himself is, again, he's a hero of old. He's gone up and down. He can really bring a lot of damage, but a lot of crowd control is going to be the big one. Not only does he have the frost magic, just kind of a little bit like Jaina, but at this point, it's going to be more around him. He can stop out heroes. He can slow them down, and he also has a death coil ready to go to throw at anybody fleeing the scene of the crime. So Arthas by himself, we don't really see a lot of, but coming into this one, if he can stall out long enough for the damage dealers of his team to kind of catch up, that could be a very powerful combo.
Well, we'll see how Arthas will pay off for the Mad Banners here, as they, again, they've got an interesting hero, but they do have the potential lockdown if, of course, they can keep everyone together. The final pickup here is Dan Lee for three, and he'll be picking up Falstead, which I believe is another hero that we haven't seen again. So they're bringing out all the heroes.
Man, we've actually had now a really good spread of heroes within these last four sets of matches, but Falstead, just like a Brightwing, is a flying hero. Does not actually have a traditional mount, but he can get from point A to point B in a very short amount of time. That's a big advantage as to why you take the Falstead. We call it global presence.
Yeah, he's it's also a bit of a hybrid. He's one that brings in a solid amount of attack damage, but he also has solid burst as well. Here we go. Here's his abilities. He has Hammer Ring. It's a little lightning bolt that, or his hammer, he'll throw it. It'll slow players down, do damage to them. He has Lightning Rod, which again is some damage that he can put on someone. Great against Illidan players in particular, so they probably will use that. And of course, Barrel Roll is an ability that gives them a quick dash to escape. But the main thing that you'll normally see here is Hendron Blast. It brings in a lot of damage really quickly to a fight. Mighty Gust is potentially something that could be done here, but it requires really strong coordination for teams to happen. So if his teammates believe in him, it will knock people or knock opponents back. So you can kind of section off teams here and there and focus someone down.
Now, I'm going to agree that it's very likely a Hinterland's Blast here because of the Chen pickup that we went over a little bit earlier. That mighty, that not the Mighty Barrel, but the Wandering Barrel, it is a mighty pick, but at the same time, you don't need two really big displacement heroics on your team. You really are going to need that damage from the Hinterland Blast, and we're going to look for the coordination as well. It's going to be up to the Tricky Turtles to really set up for that Hinterland's Blast because there is a little bit of a windup. There is a potential it misses.
Yeah. It is potentially a thing that could happen. But just looking at the entire comp here for the Tricky Turtles, I like it. They're trying to just section off Illidan in any way, shape, or form, get rid of him, take him out of the fight immediately, and then at that point, they have a 5v4, and with strong mechanics, they can win the fight very, very quickly. So I like their picks. It's different. It's bold. It's something that requires them to be on point, and they have the trust in each other to potentially pull off that coordination. You're either going home, or you're going to the Epic 8. Why not try something crazy, and this is the moment to do it. I'm excited.
I believe you're looking for it. It's time to go big or go home.
Yeah, definitely, man.
And that's what we're going to see. I mean, again, like we saw this in the previous matchup, Sonya coming out of nowhere, Nova coming out of nowhere, and now we're seeing three brand new heroes on the stream. Heroes of the Storm is definitely a versatile game, and these teams, they definitely know what they're doing.
All right, game number three. Get ready, get excited. Loser goes home. Winner goes to the Epic 8. The, on the very far right, the Tricky Turtles here, RPSD, Chirino, Dan Lee for three, Monkey Lamps, and of course, Beto. They're trying to split up a little bit and get some coordination going on. front. There it is. They got some formation. Looking great, guys.
It's almost a star.
Yeah, almost a star. And then Mad Banners, let's get a quick introduction for them. Kakisho, Dan, Mr. Berkeys, and of course, in the top left corner, Sada Haru.
Yeah, so again, this is a map we have seen before, but this is the first time we're going to see these guys on it. The big thing, again, Wrath not playing that warrior. He is on the Tassadar into the bottom lane. He has swapped roles a little bit, and again, it goes to show the versatility here of the team from the Illinois, because, man, like, you don't really see that a lot. You know, we have seen really just a lot of static roles for some of these players, but swapping it up like this, especially in a game three, they got to be very confident that they know what they're doing.
And I hope they are as well. Mr. Berkey and Dan looking confident already. If they can hit a Howling Blast, which is the way that Mr. Berkey can lock someone down on Jaina, Dan and Kakisho with the CC and the damage could potentially get rid of her very, very quickly. But with Monkey Lambs and Beto here, it looks like this lane overall will be a couple trades, but no real major kill potential. So let's go ahead and check out the top lane here as we have Falstad. You see him flying around there with his Griffin. Sada Haru and him, well, we do have a couple trade-offs overall. If Dan for three misses any of his abilities, Sada Haru can win this lane pretty easily, especially with the help here of Mr. Berkey's and Dan.
Oh, look at this. I mean, Dan right there, Mr. Berkey's, like, that is a very terrifying opening takedown potential, because again, you know, we're going to be looking to this guy, Mr. Berkey's, on that Arthas. He's going to be looking for Howling Blast. That's the Tempest. Everything he does basically slows you down, and if he can slow you enough, that's going to be a stun from Kakisho. That could be the engage from Dan. We've seen Dan, you know, parkouring around a lot of these team fights, a lot of these maps. If he has that control and he can, and you can't outrun this combo, that's going to be a takedown.
All right, so immediately the Bad Banners are actually in enemy territory as they move here quickly to grab seeds. They steal 15 seeds from them on the right side. They have taken away seeds from the Tricky Turtles. They're going to be taking out these little small shamblers, these little flowers here, if you will, and just grab all the seeds possible. Normally teams will grab 30 in the early game. Already the Mad Banners are at 45. This is a pretty big advantage.
Yeah, Sada Haru immediately transitioned from the top to get his own seeds, and with those three of the four going the way, that's why you see the split, 45-15. That was a very bold move, but it paid off. The Mad Banners will take the advantage, but this is actually curious. Tricky Turtles is saying we're not going to be outdone. They're going early for the big guy who holds 60 seeds.
Yeah, this is actually not normal in any way, shape, or form. This Golem is pretty strong early on, and your heroes just aren't strong enough to actually take it. But with a team of four, they're able to grab the top one. On the opposite side of the map, though, the Mad Banners are grabbing their own. They've realized the Tricky Turtles are doing this weird play, so they're going to match them here. In fact, it works out better for the Mad Banners because they actually are now grabbing a Terror. It's an early one, so it's not the strongest one possible, but still, if you grab a Terror early, you still have the potential to do something in lane.
And something is what we're going to have to kind of figure out. What is the Mad Banners going to do with this very early Terror? Because again, somebody has to pilot it. If I have to guess, it's either going to be one of these two characters, Mr. Berks or Dan, and it looks like it's going to be Mr. Berks to jump into it. You see him heading home, he's going to put on the suit and start boxing around in one of these lanes. But which lane will be supported? Will be a split push? What are the Mad Banners going to do?
Okay, well, looking at it, Mr. Berkey, it looks like he's going to queue up to head straight to the middle lane. You see him having a little bit of lines behind him. It means he sprinted in. While the rest of the team here, Kakisho, are grabbing as much as they can. I like the choice here of grabbing the Giants before getting the Terror, so they have the added potential of bringing the damage. And you see the Tricky Turtles. They realize this is a big deal. Three of them have come middle to defend this. While in the top lane, we have the other two teammates, Dan and Sarahara, just trying to put pressure on this wall. And RPSD, although he is a nice little strong, I guess, dwarf, he's able to actually, or Viking, he's actually not able to be able to defend this. So he has to be careful, as RPSD might be able to get picked off real quickly.
Yeah, I mean, they jumped on top of Dan Lee for three, but he has that barrel roll ready to go. Chirano was actually trying to follow suit, but she doesn't have those innate escapes, and you can see she can't actually join her teammates very safely here, but the rotation is there. Tricky Turtle's coming for the defense. Bottom lane, Tassadar didn't come. Uther in the mid is also holding that down. So not only did the Tricky Turtles go to defend en masse, they're actually now starting to lose out some of this pressure in the other lanes.
I like their play here of only going for the turrets. You see them putting down that huge plant. They're right in the middle. It starts suctioning away the life here from the turrets. And killing those turrets off does award your team experience. So they've actually been able to get a pretty decent lead overall. They're about to hit level 8 to the level 7 of the Tricky Turtles. They've grabbed both turrets in the middle lane, which makes their minions a little bit stronger. And it looks like we're going to have the Terror start to phase out in the next couple of seconds, but overall they've gotten four turrets.
And they got that last planter there as well, which is disabling this gate and starting to really take it down. If you don't auto-attack it, it's going to get a full duration. Oh, it's so close! They get the tower, and that will put them even closer now to level 10. Those heroics that we're looking for at that talent tier. So far, the race is being won out by the Mad Banners.
Yeah, the Mad Banners with their early game strategy of grabbing as much seeds as possible and luckily, or not luckily, but strategically able to grab a Terra early has awarded them that small lead. The question is, can they keep that lead? You see the Tricky Turtles on the right side of the map right now trying to figure out what they want to do in posturing. They're grabbing these knights, these bruisers in the top right corner, which will push their top lane. But right now, they have to find a way to get back into an even way here in terms of level. And the way to do that is by securing a couple takedowns.
Now, a little bit earlier, we also saw some mercenary camps being taken before that Terror did spawn. We did see Siege Giants here in the middle. We had Siege Giants in the bottom. So we don't really have too many options available now to the Tricky Turtles because we don't have those cooldowns. On the flip side, though, you can now see these bruisers pushing in against the Lone Viking. He is going to be able to gain that experience for his team, but he's not going to be able to deal with these bruisers in any quick fashion.
Yeah, he's going to try his best. And in the middle lane, you see Illidan. We have Arthas. The two players kind of floating around as Monkey Lamps and Beto trying to find their way to help out. The question for the Tricky Turtles is how they force an engagement. And it looks like they're finally going to be able to do it as both teams are going to contest over this Garden Terror down here on the bottom right.
Yeah, but we're about to hit level 10, and already we're catching Toronto. If Toronto actually is about to stay here with that level 10, there it is. We're looking for these stuns, but unfortunately, she gets away. Kakisho is still actually trying to chase her down, but it's not meant to be. Here comes Syndragosa, though, the Arthas. It's going to stop out any kind of firing from that keep and still slow down the heroes. Unfortunately, not too much was actually going to be gained for it, but they do catch Eric in the back as well as Bela. Three of those Vikings actually played up by RPSD, all three of them removed off the map.
Well, nicely done here by the Mad Banners. It could have been a lot worse for the Tricky Turtles, but they did a good job of peeling back. Mr. Berkey's, by the way, grabbing the Cinder Ghost, that was a huge dragon you saw fly over a couple of members, is a bit of an odd pick. It's a bit different. And what it does is it does CC the opposing heroes by slowing them down, which allows the Illidan player, the Dan up there, the potential to catch up and chase them down. So interesting pick, but one that might cost Arthas potential deaths as he loses a lot of tankiness by giving up that heroic that he had, the Army of the Dead, which is the other one he has.
Yeah, the Army of the Dead is sacrificable ghouls for health. It's definitely a mainstay talent of his, but with the Syndragosa, the Mad Banners are saying, we're just going to go offensive. We got to catch him, we got to kill, we got to take them down, and that's what they're going to do. Kakisho, however, finds RPSD, who's in that Terror. Here's the Hinterland Blast, and the lockdown is perfect. Uther is now into that ethereal form. Bathysai into the side. He's gaining that brew. He's probably going to be jumping in as quick as he can. He does have the Wandering Barrel ready to go. Wrath is on the retreat. He's not looking so healthy, but by the end of it all, the gate is going to fall and the one takedown for the Tricky Turtles.
And the RPSD team has now gotten to a point where they're almost even up the game overall. Dan trying to find a way to get in position, but RPSD does sniff him out, throws down an ability, and it looks like the Tricky Turtles are trying to grab more seeds here. They've positioned themselves in a great position to grab whatever they can. RPSD is on the right side here with that Viking boat that he could potentially be using as he's floating around. He's going to start grabbing experience, but let's go back to the Terror as it looks there might be a fight here in a second. There goes Cinder Ghost. The huge dragon flies over four members. Dan runs in. He's able to start knocking down Dan for lead. Can he use Metamorphosis? Jester, this game is pretty close.
Yeah, the barrel coming up a little bit way too late on top of that. Illidan. Dan is into the back. One and two for the takedowns. RPSD is finished out with that Garden Terror. You see the boat, but the boat does not last whatsoever. A great hook there from Burks with that Howling Blast. It stops those Vikings from running away, and Eric the Swift is earning that name by being very swift on the retreat, and he is just not going to be able to do anything against the big five-man crew that Mad Banners are currently.
Yeah, Mad Banners didn't lose a single member in that entire fight. They are now going to secure a fort. The fort will get them a little bit closer to level 13. The game is a little bit now in the favor of the Mad Banners. Tricky Turtles now grouping up a little bit down here in the bottom right corner, but fights cannot go that unfortunate there for the Tricky Turtles if they keep continuing moving forward. They need to find some kind of lockdown and make sure when that dragon comes their way, they're able to A, fully engage, or they need to try and dodge it in some way or shape or form because they will get caught.
Now, this is something that I personally actually didn't even see, but we have a back-to-back Terror situation here for the Tricky Turtles. They weren't taking the team fights, but when they weren't fighting, they were seeding very hard. This is the second Terror, back-to-back before the next night cycle, and it is being piloted once again by one of the Vikings.
So they did lose members and lost experience overall, but what they did gain for grabbing those seeds is the Terror, as Jesper just mentioned, which will allow for them to try and come back in this fight and get a little bit even. In fact, they're about to hit level 13, especially if they take out these turrets. Nicely done by them. So they're using these vehicles, these Terrors, to their full advantage. We do see a member up here at the top right corner, Illidan and Uther, trying to come around. Dan Kakisho and Mr. Berkey's do come in. They go straight for Monkey Lamps. Monkey Lamps uses a huge heal on himself. Dan Lee for three in trouble as well, but the Wandering Ked from Beto is knocking everyone away. Beautifully done by the Panda. Dan in the top right corner trying to fight, but overall, the fight looks like it's going in the favor of the Tricky Turtles.
Yeah, we're just too split up here. I mean, Mr. Burke's on one side, Dan on the other. Dan has got to be the big target because he's into that back line. He's doing that. I mean, he avoids the Hinderland Blast. Dan Lee for three doesn't actually land the kill. Here comes the shields and the heals. It's keeping Dan up, and now RPSD is going to be the only one here with Battlesai. Battlesai, however, is still not really able to do the big damage. He's a big tanky panda. He doesn't really assassinate people, and Dan somehow is still alive. He's now going on top of this panda. The Viking in that Garden Terror doesn't really know which way to go, and I gotta say, A-plus right there to Dan.
Yeah, Dan and Wrath right there, usually using their synergies of their two heroes to really make a couple of plays there. They took out Dan Lee for three, which was a false, and that brought a lot of damage. He dodged the Hinterland Blast, as mentioned by Jester, which allowed for him to make those plays. Now, overall, for the most part, both teams are very neck and neck right now. These fights are so back and forth, heavyweights going at it, and we're gonna see that tempo continue as we go throughout the game here, as the Tricky Turtles just hit 15. The Mad Barons are a little bit behind here, but once they grab these Giants, they should be able to grab it.
That's something to note, though. Because of so many takedowns and those double back-to-back Terrors, it's actually the experienced lead for the Tricky Turtles. You saw them hit 15 first. If they can keep up with this level of play, they're going to be able to make up for those early game blunders and come into a late game scenario where they are potentially going to be able to put up the win and advance to the Epic 8.
Wrath realizes that the entire team here for the Tricky Turtles is right below him. He's going to go ahead and pull on back. Wrath and Sadaharu are here. We now have the Night Sequence now popping up on the Garden of Terror. We see the Tricky Turtles are going to be grabbing the first amount of seeds, but the Mad Banners, as you can see, have 74 seeds, and they need a few more so they can get their own Terror, and they're doing that on the opposite side of the map. They're down in the very bottom right, grabbing their own Terror here to take out and grab as much seeds as possible.
So it looks like we're going to trade out these Terrors, but I do not believe that's actually going to be a Terror for the side of the Tricky Turtles. It's almost guaranteed now here for the Mad Banners. There it is. It's starting its growth cycle, but I don't think we have enough seeds ready for the Tricky Turtles. The quick math might actually fail me, but it doesn't. 91. This is the danger of having back-to-back. You typically start off the next night cycle very low on seeds, and if you cannot get an aggressive seed position, you will be denied a third.
All right, well, the Mad Banners do have a slight advantage right now. They do have a Terror in their available for them. And you know what's interesting, by the way, in terms of strategy? Mr. Berkey's did grab the Cindergosa, but when he grabs the Terror, eventually he actually does become a tank in some way or some form, as he's now a robust Terror. So interesting pickup and interesting strategy from the Mad Banners, as they're now using the Terror as their warrior to start engagements, as well as help them break down forts.
It's still neck and neck with the experience. Level 16 apiece. We have now hit those final power-up phases. The next one is going to be the Storm Tier Talents at level 20. 12 minutes in, it's still really anybody's way to go. There goes the fort here in the mid. We don't have too many forts left here for Tricky Turtles. In fact, it's only that bottom lane one. Is that actually going to be the big target? It looks like the transition will come in. They're not going to start trying to push their luck and push in on top of a more important keep, but instead, they're going to be looking to soak not only this experience and gain that experience for them, but they're also looking to augment that with more siege damage and the experience granted from those.
The Mad Banners have the Terror for another 45 seconds. That has a little over 75% HP as well, so looking nice and healthy. The Tricky Turtles dancing around here behind the turrets. This is where the point of engagement will happen if there is going to be a fight. You're going to watch out there for Kakisho there to really land his Divine Storm. He's the important one here. And also watch Beto. If he can get a full engagement where he can jump in and use that Wandering Keg and potentially start a fight, he will. So watch for the dancing here. Mr. Berkey taking a lot of damage. They finally get the wall. He's going to go ahead and pull on back and move towards the mid lane.
15 seconds left. There's still actually a good chunk of hit points here for Mr. Berkey, but that just means that you can continue doing some of these more aggressive plays. They get the gate bottom, they're not getting this gate top. That's almost putting them in a full level advantage after this. Mr. Berkey comes out of it, but he's not going to be a squishy target. He is Arthas, that warrior class. And if he does need to be here in a pinch, he can Cindergosa, and that will be the signal for the team to re-engage. But either way, now going into 18, because of all of those pushes, the fort, and the double gates, that's a lot of experience back into the pockets of Mad Banners.
So in terms of level, we're really even. We're about to be 18-17, but looking at forts, it's 6 forts for the Mad Banners, only 3 for the Tricky Turtles. Connecticut is looking very, very strong right now, while Connecticut's actually looking a little bit behind, while Illinois looks very strong at the moment, and they're going to keep up this pressure. They want to take out more keeps if possible, but they also have to be aware of potentially Connecticut coming in and trying to take out some kind of fort.
I gotta say, the University of Illinois at Urbana has really practiced Heroes of the Storm. I mean,
not only
did they get to the Super 16, but they're very much on poise here to grab. If they can get this kill on top of RAPSD, yeah, we gotta be very quiet.
This is an important moment. If RPSD is taken out, he could be in a lot of trouble. However, the actual Mad Banners are bottom right. They're actually going in for a fight right below because they have the Vikings out of position. There goes Cinder Ghost. It hits 3 members. However, it is unfortunate for the Mad Banners as the entire ult or the heroic hit behind enemy lines, which means that they can't really dive into that. So now a heroic down for Mr. Burks, and Monkey Lambs is charging in.
Yeah, Mr. Burks turns right back around and says, I'm not going to take this, Monkey Lambs. Here comes the barrel and the boat. A lot of damage and a lot of knockbacks now going back and forth. Arthas is going to be the big target, and there goes Mr. Burks. He's done and out of it. But Battleside, with that ancestral healing, he gets healed up by Monkey Lambs, and that's keeping him in this fight. The Illidan in the back. Dan, can he actually replicate what he did last round? I'm not thinking so. He's down 3 teammates, but he's going to make the best bet that he can on top of Chirano. That's a lot of slow right there. Dan has to get in there. Can he actually get that one crucial last auto attack? He can, and the basic attacks are enough. Dan, once more, showing us the power of that Illidan, whereas the rest of his team, unfortunately, is going to fall.
Yeah, unfortunately is the correct word here, as Tricky Turtles were able to take out 4 members of the Mad Banners. It's just Dan by himself. Luckily, he was able to secure a takedown, so that's helpful. So he's able to grab a couple of seeds. But if we look at the rest of the red team, they're actually floating around here, trying to grab as much seeds as possible. Great team fight by the Tricky Turtles. They realized the Mad Banners were down 1 heroic. They didn't have Cinder Ghost, that huge dragon that flies over. So they went in for it. And overall, they did great. They had a 4-for-2 trade, which is, at any point in the game, is always a solid trade for your team.
Now, there's a big blunder right there from the Mad Banners. Not only did they not have the Cinder Ghost already because they just used it moments before, but at the same time, they weren't able to bring down Chen for a takedown. He got really low, and he's a warrior. He's meant to take all this kind of damage, but the damage piled up, and then he got ancestrally healed from Monkey Labs. That by itself right there basically won the rest of the fight for the Tricky Turtles, and once more, they take the experience lead. It's going back and forth so very quickly and so very often, but the Tricky Turtles do have those storm tier talents.
Jester, we're getting into the late game of this best of 3. Remember, game number 3 winner will be going to the Epic 8 next Saturday on ESPN3. Monkey Lambs and Dan Lee for 3 are leading the charge as the Tricky Turtles are trying to grab their own terror. Remember, they are level 20, so they are a little bit ahead in experience, but at the same time, the Mad Banners in the bottom left and the middle are just now grabbing 20. They have secured it. This game is neck and neck. Overall, there is a better infrastructure for the Mad Banners, but at any point, if there is a team fight that goes in the favor of any team, they could potentially take the win.
Now, finally, we put some siege damage, some infrastructure down for the Mad Banners. You can see RPSD, he's really confident, he's up here. One of those Vikings are in that suit. Here's the other two coming into it. He has to now control them and the other Vikings, but the barrel comes out. Battleside is really just trying to knock them around, separate out this team. The Hinterlands Blast does some damage, but only on top of Mr. Burks. Doesn't really hit the back line that it needs to. Wrath has that Archon going, but he's actually running away. He's now out of it, and Sadahara with the strafe. It will keep the team of the Tricky Turtles at bay, but there's no takedowns.
The Tricky Turtles are winning this fight overall. They've gotten the Mr. Burks Terra a little bit weaker. And for the most part, they used a lot of the heroics from the Mad Banners. They were actually a bit of a deficit in terms of actual cooldowns. You see Batto charging on in. Remember, he still has his wandering keg. The team needs to be careful. RPSD charging in. Dan in trouble. There's a Viking boat. Dan Lee for 3. Using that hammer to knock some damage down. Monkey Lambs helping out a lot. There goes the heal on Dan Lee for 3. But Batto finally gets taken out. And overall, it's a 1-for-1 trade, as we also saw the Arthas taken down as well.
Both of the Warriors are going to trade out their takedowns here, but it's still very much anybody's game. RPSD, that Olaf is getting chunked down really hard. He's going to be the big kill and the big takedown, and he's going to be out of it for a little bit. The rest of the Vikings on the retreat. The rest of the team of the Tricky Turtles are out of this as well. But it's not over really from either side. We have still so many mercenary camps to regroup and take down. And at the same time, 96 seeds are in the bank here of the Tricky Turtles. The next night phase will yield a very quick terror.
That it will. So we're going to be watching out for that next night phase, which will be pretty soon. Right now, the Mad Banner's grabbing whatever they can. They're grabbing their Giants over here on the far left. They'll probably grab their Bruisers below that as well. Both teams just trying to grab some kind of map control. They want to make sure that they're able to get pressure in any way, shape, or form. That way, they, of course, can start team fights if they would like to. So we see that happening here in the middle lane for the red team as they have these minions pushing forward, but the Giants will be able to help clear that up. Everyone else is grouping up here in the top right.
Now, again, 20 minutes into this, we have level 20 to 21. Storm tier talents are on both sides of the fence. But this is also just an extremely close game overall. 9 takedowns to 9.75. That is a very close score. And going back and forth, I mean, there's still half a level between these teams in terms of experience. Is this a tricky maneuver? Are we actually going to go for this quick ambush on top of Chirona?
They were going to try it. Jaina was able to get away, but Sadahuru is down here on the top of RPSD. Sadahuru is in trouble, though. He's getting knocked around by this keg here from Beto. There goes the Hindrain Blast in the bottom right corner. Sadahuru is somehow staying alive from nice heals from his teammates, but overall, it finally looks like Monkey Lambs is trying to get the last bite on top of Sadahuru. He's finally going to be taken out. Chirino low on health, but just kidding, as Monkey Lambs does heal him up. Dan going forward, trying to chase down Monkey Lambs. He will be falling down, and here we go. Mr. Berkey's chasing down Chirino as well. If Chirino does fall, we could potentially have the Mad Banners keep chasing, but Chirino does not fall.
Now we're overextending way too hard to try to get Chirena. Already 1, 2, and 3. There's the 1, 2 punches on top of 3 of these heroes from the Mad Banners. Now Wrath is there. Dan is going to be the last one standing, but they've committed way too many resources to try to take out the Jaina, to try to take out Chirona. Kakicho does have that redemption. That's why he's back alive, but it's not going to be a pretty ending for him, as Battlesai and Dan Lee for 3 are going to secure one more takedown on the back of that. This is a phenomenal position, because the Tricky Turtles only lost out a Viking as well as a Rhaegar. They kept up Chirona, but they also have the map positioning to grab 2 back-to-back Terrors.
And all 5 members for the Mad Banners were taken out. Oh my gosh, a Terror will be growing in a couple of seconds, so the Tricky Turtles will be able to grab it. They just secured the seat.
It's done. They didn't put on the suit. I lied.
Just kidding. 3 seconds, and there goes the Terra. It's just now spawning. They were able to grab a couple of seeds, and we just now have Mad Banner's one member just spawned, and that will be the Vala player. There is one more popping up in a couple of seconds here, so in about a total of 25 seconds, the entire Mad Banner's team will be up, but the Tricky Turtles will be prepared. They have that Garden Terra back at home that they can grab. They can use this Terra here. They're actually going to put RPSD in it, which, by the way, he'll have 2 other Vikings that he can control while this is happening, and just push down some lane in some way or some form. I would recommend probably the top lane, but it looks like they're going to be grabbing the Bruisers too. So yeah, the top lane would be great here.
Just taking a quick moment there to say, Dan Lee for 3, that was the fly that we saw from the Falsehead. He came in from base, flew all the way to the point. That's the global presence we're talking about. He can go from point A to point B very quickly, and that is definitely something we've been seeing a lot of from Dan Lee. We finally got to show it to you. Falsehead by himself is a really fun hero. He can do a lot of damage, a lot of single target. The Hinterland Blast combos have more or less not done the damage they need to, but Dan Lee for 3 has landed it when it really counts, and that is why we're seeing, again, a little bit more of the map presence, the global presence here from the Tricky Turtles. Now, RPSD has 100% been doing the Viking split. He has one Viking in there, controls the other 2. Doesn't really seem to be doing much with them right now, but going into this, we have another Terran behind this as well.
That dragon was very nice there from Mr. Burks. Where is Illidan, though? Illidan should have followed up into a Metamorphosis, and he's not going to do it. He's actually floating around the back left corner. He's waiting for Beto to watch out for the Wandering Keg, but Uther falls because of it. Finally, Wrath and Sadaharu and Dan engage the fight, but it might be too late, as all the members for the Tricky Turtles are chasing down Wrath. He's low on HP. Dan as low as well, but all the members are still here for the Tricky Turtles. Are they going to secure the fort? They do get it. Can they win the game here, Jester? Can they push?
Well, if they don't win it here, they have another Terra in the bank, but that's still a very healthy RPSD Viking-controlled plant. And with those planters and the rest of the team, the defense, I just don't think it's here. And the Mad Banners, Illinois from Urbana, is actually going to drop 2-1 in our game 3 of this best of 3 here in Heroes of the Dorm Super 16.
The Tricky Turtles will grab game number 3, and they'll be moving on to the Epic 8 for next Saturday on ESPN3. Congratulations to them. A good game overall between the two schools, though. I can't believe how close that was.
I mean, not only did we finally get to see a game 3 between these teams, but but so close. The experience lead going back and forth, the advantages just going back and forth and back and forth. I mean, there's no other way to say it. That was a very exciting game.
That it was, my friend. I can't believe how close it was. I do feel like the Mad Banners in that last couple seconds of fight missed a huge opportunity. We had a great Sindergosa from the Arthas player, Mr. Burks, I believe, and yep. The Illidan player missed out on the huge metamorphosis. Whenever you go onto a number of heroes, you get a huge health pool and a nice amount of attack speed, so you want to grab as much valuable. You need to be greedy late game. Remember, go big or go home. And unfortunately, he's a little bit too scared to go home.
Well, perhaps in that instance, but overall, I mean, the Mad Banners putting up a phenomenal game series against the Tricky Turtles. The picks going back and forth from the user-generated brackets that we had people submit did actually put these teams very close to each other to make it not only to the round of 16, but the round of 8, so it was a toss-up. I got to say, though, the Tricky Turtles, University of Connecticut, got to be very proud today.
Yep, and let's go ahead and check out one replay that will showcase exactly what happened in that game. We believe this is a major turning point that happened here, as the blue team was in a great position overall. They wanted to go in for engagement. They were looking for Chirino overall. Sadaharu went in for the engagement. He's getting knocked back left and right here by Bado. Nicely done. There was a Hinterland Blast in the bottom right corner, but you could just see Dan Lee for 3, Monkey Lance coming in and really converging on the entire area. Chirino, by the way, low on health points, doesn't care, went in to help his teammates, and now this is a 5v4 situation. The Tricky Turtles really are just using their teamwork overall. Monkey Lamps does get picked off, but you can watch Chirino over here on the right side. He's low on HP. If you secure that takedown, Mad Banners might be in a decent position, and they went for it. Unfortunately, with great teamwork here by the Tricky Turtles, they were able to save him. Dan Lee for 3, using that hybrid damage, is able to finally take out Dan, as well as Wrath in the top left corner.
I gotta say, I mean, so much was committed to Chirino. At the same time, Monkey Lamps with his phenomenal healing overall, all 3 games. I cannot say enough about Monkey Lamps and his play. We're gonna watch Kakisho, actually. He came back from the redemption, but unfortunately, he's just gonna go right back down. Dan Lee for 3 and Batosai able to clean up at the end of it all. But I gotta give it, MVP was Monkey Lamps.
Yeah.
He might have paid for it with his life a few times on a takedown or two, but he overall was a super effective healer, and it really did show in a lot of those team fights.
Yeah, that's a good thing. If you're a support player like Monkey Lamps was playing, he's playing Rhaegar, and you're taking a lot of damage at for your team and being a thorn in the side of the opponent, and then they're focusing you down towards the late time of a fight, oh my gosh, you're playing so well at that point. So nice job to Monkey Lamps.
Yeah, absolutely. So that is going to do it for our match set number 4 here of the Super 16, which means that we're more or less about halfway done our content for today.
Yep, and that means we're actually done with this program block. We're going to be having another block showing up on another stream, so please join us after the quick commercial break. We're going to be jumping to a different program, so go ahead and on the right side of your screen, click the Heroes of the Dorm link. That way you can jump into the next match with us, because we'll be going for the next couple hours. It is currently listed under 7 p.m., so make sure to click that bad boy.